when the face was presented with the name, I'm like, I know that brother. Let me go a little further. His wife is the daughter of the person I used to sing in my men's choir at my church. It's kind of crazy, like, how God connect people who are destined to be connected and to do his purpose. It's real crazy. Edward L. Fairley is the founder and president of No Love Inc., whose mission is to decrease tomorrow's divorce rate today by enlightening singles and couples alike on the topics of effective communication and the entire life cycle of intimate relationships. He brings a vast amount of wisdom and years of experience in relationship coaching and counseling services to his company. He is the author of the Handbook for Increasing Your Relationship IQ, a product of years of research into relationship intelligence. No Love Inc. is a realization of Mr. Fairley's passion for an all-inclusive, proven method of relationship counseling that is fun and stimulates real-life experiences. Hence, No Love, the app, is also being created. Edward L. Fairley has been married for over a decade. Get a man around the clock. And his beautiful wife. And he has three lovely children. Me didn't want to show you that. A man that stays with him, stay married, and still stay a father. No, the media ain't gonna put that out there. Today he's here to take us on a journey from no love to no love. Without further, I want to introduce you to my friend, my brother, Mr. Edward L. Fairley.
Let's go ahead and clear the air. I'm not like any of the persons that have taught you all prior to me in reference to relationships. First of all, let's start with one big thing, which would be I have no degrees. I dropped out of college, so that's one strike against me. I am not a celebrity. I probably got 300 followers on Facebook. I don't have many followers on Twitter either. But I am married, as they stated. I've been married actually going on 12 years. Thank you. I do your life in the audience. I'm going on 9 years of being happily married. So that means the first 3 years was hell. Let's start there. This is where my qualifications begin to come into play. My first 3 years of marriage was hell. My wife can attest to this. And that's where my journey began. We had a horrible time in the beginning. And it just so happened to be that at that time, I was a technician for Cox Communication. And they taught us as technicians to start with where the signal is good and work your way back to figure out where the problem is. So I figured, let me go ahead and try to take this approach on my marriage. So I began to troubleshoot my own marriage. So I started where it was bad, which was my marriage, and I worked my way back to the beginning of my marriage. And I found an aha moment, so to speak, but I couldn't stop there. It still was bad. So I went back to relationship. And when we began our relationship, And I had aha moments as to where we went wrong there, but I couldn't stop there. So I went back to when we were dating, and I found an aha moment there, but I couldn't stop there. So I went back to when I was dating other people, had another few aha moments there, and I couldn't stop there. And then I ended up stopping at myself, which is so perfect because it helped me realize I had self-esteem issues, which is a perfect platform for this entire event, so to speak. So what I want to do is, I want to take a journey, as my company states, from no love to no love collectively. And I actually titled this segment, Building a House of Love from No Love to No Love, Starting with the Foundation of Self-Esteem. Now, where I'm different in the other people that you all have seen teaching in reference to relationships is, I guess, my biggest thing is parables, stories, so to speak. So when I went to an event, it was a networking event years ago, and as we were networking, we exchanged a lot of cards, and I ended up with a stack of cards about this thick, and I had it in my shirt pocket. So by the time I got home, I saw my kitchen floor was pretty dirty. So I decided to clean, so I started sweeping. I swept, and then I got a nice little pile of dirt and stuff from what I saw on the floor, and I saw the pile, went and got the dustpan, and I reached over to sweep up the dust, all right? And when I reached over, cards started falling outside of my pocket. So just out of habit, I started reaching for the cards. And what happened? More cards fell out. And I still kept reaching for the cards. More cards fell out. Until I finally pressed my chest to stop the cards from coming out, took the cards out, put them on the counter, and then I cleaned up the mess and got the cards out. So what am I saying? Typically when people teach you, they teach you to attack the symptom but not the problem, okay? So what I'm going to do today, and until I die, because I know my purpose, is I'm going to help you all see the root of why things are the way that they are. We're going to press our chest. We're going to stop these cards so that we can eventually clean up the problem that we have now. See, it's interesting that those who are the celebrities, those who do have the PhDs and everything, they've been the ones teaching all this time, yet the divorce rate is increasing. It's decreasing. So it's time for something different, and I'm going to provide you with that something different because I have been tasked by God to help you all see, not even teach you, but help you realize what's been teaching and causing the divorce rate to increase by those who are the quoted experts, so to speak, okay? All right, so y'all willing to take the journey from me?
Yeah.
All right, so now the thing is, it comes at a cost. First of all, you're gonna get your money's worth. I promise you that, but you're gonna feel uncomfortable. All right? You're gonna feel uncomfortable, I promise you that, and it's out of love because I'm going to snatch stuff that you thought was the truth right from under your legs. Unapologetic, but I am gonna provide you with the reason why it has not been the truth. Y'all okay with that?
Yeah.
All right, it doesn't really matter. It's like hide and go seek, ready or not, here I come. All right? Okay, all right, so high heels and low self-esteem. I'm so glad that Ms. Taisha coordinated this event because, especially in my field, because low self-esteem is a hidden, deeply rooted contributor to issues in every phase of relationships, whether it be dating, relationships, or the marriage phase. So, like any 12-step program, the first step is to be honest and admit or realize that you have a problem, okay? So I took the time to identify signs of low self-esteem in each relationship phase. Let's start with the dating phase. This is when you're single and you don't really have someone to call your own, but you would like to. So signs of low self-esteem in the dating phase are feeling like because you're not settled down with someone by a certain age that you are a failure or hate being alone. So let's address that. First of all, if you are deciding that by a certain age, I should be married or with someone, you are determining your value by being with someone else. It's a problem. And if you don't like being by yourself, how do you expect somebody else to like being with you? So these are signs of low self-esteem. Then another sign for relationships are doing stuff for the person that you don't like, or doing stuff for this for that person that's demeaning just to keep them around. Or another one is to be with someone that you know is terrible or not for you because you don't want to be alone. I get this all the time. People tell me how terrible the guy or the girl is, and I'm like, well, why? Why are you staying there? What's the problem? Why would you stay in there? And they tell me, because I don't want to be alone. Well, if you don't want to be with you, why do you expect somebody else to want to be with you? To say that you don't want to be alone is to say that you don't want to spend time with yourself. And if you don't want to spend time with yourself, I promise you, no one else is either. Another sign for you married folk out there. These are signs that you have low self-esteem. You think to yourself or say to your spouse things like, I need reassurance. It's not that I don't trust you. I just know how they are. I just know how guys are. I just know how girls are. First of all, that means you don't trust them. Because in the end, it takes two to tangle. So whether the other guy or the other girl is trifling, it's going to take for them to be receptive to it in order for anything to happen. So indirectly, you really don't trust them. Okay? And then if you're saying stuff like, I need reassurance, that means, again, you are dependent on the outside source to make you feel good about yourself. That's a problem. That is a clear sign that you have self-esteem issues, and you need to address that immediately. So now we have kind of an idea as to what low self-esteem looks like, and now because I have a problem with people bringing up low self-esteem but never addressing how in the world do you fix it? Anybody ever seen that? You talk about low self-esteem, you got poems about low self-esteem, but nobody tells you how to fix low self-esteem. So we're gonna work on that today. All right? First, there's a few steps. The first thing you have to do is to become a student of self. Remember I said I had to work my way back, and I finally got to myself? You have to be a student of self. And the way you do that is to ask yourself why questions about yourself until you can't ask why anymore. So many people don't know who they are or understand who they are. You should know why you're upset. You should know why you're happy. You should understand why this. For example, I'm a very confident person. I know why that is. Why? I had to ask why questions. Because when I was a child, my mother was the type of person that if I had a spelling test, she would say, okay, say the word was water. She's like, all right, LeVar. She calls me by my middle name. I'm Edward L. Fairley. She said, all right, LeVar, how you spell water? And I go, W-A-T-E-R, water. And she'd be like, nope, that's wrong. I'm like, for real? No, but because you were not sure, it is wrong. Now go back in the room and study all your words. So she made me know what I know what I know. You can't question yourself. If you question yourself, you don't know. You either do or you don't. And you need to be combative about whether you know it or not. So that's why I'm confident. Why did I have low self-esteem? Because I was rejected by my father. Two, I saw my mother not be truthful and pretty much put other people or men before me. Three, I seen my sisters say great things about guys when they were together, and then when they left, say terrible things about them. So I thought, in my mind, people just lied anyway when they said stuff that was good. That's why I had self-esteem issues. That's why I was actually the one that was saying stuff like, I need reassurance to my wife when we were married in the beginning. Again, I had to dig. You got to dig. You gotta ask yourself why. You need to understand and know yourself. If you don't know yourself, how in the world do you expect to know how to find the person that's right for you? You don't even know who's right for you because you don't know yourself. It all starts with self. You have to know and understand yourself. Second thing, after you learn yourself, forgive yourself for anything you've done or any experiences you've had that caused you to blame yourself for how you feel about you.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta forgive yourself. It's very, very difficult, but you must forgive yourself for a few reasons. One, if you don't forgive yourself, you'll never learn how to forgive other people. Gotta start with yourself. And that is probably the epitome of love. Forgiveness. So if you don't forgive yourself, you would not be able to forgive other people, nor will you be able to be receptive to a person that genuinely forgives you. So you block your own ability to be able to be forgiven. Third, forgive others for what they did or didn't do to or for you that has you feeling the way that you feel about yourself. Remember, you gotta start with yourself first. When you forgive yourself, you can learn to forgive others. But what's even more powerful in this is, unfortunately, so many people prevent themselves from being who they were created to be, or just being someone, or being someone that they love, because they put all of who they are in the hands of other people. Yeah. I'm not this way, I'm not successful because my mother did not do this for me. I'm not this way or successful because my father was not there. I'm not this way because my wife does not support me. I'm not great at this because my husband does not support me. What those things do is snatches the power of your destiny from yourself and puts it in the hand of those people. So if my father does not come back and fix what he did, I still suck. If my mother does not come back and do what she did not do, or take back what she did or apologize, I'm never going to be able to move past this point. You are snatching all the power of your destiny from yourself and putting it in the hands of others. You have to forgive those people and then take yourself and your destiny back and move forward. You have to. Forgiveness is never for the other person, it's for you. And I can assure you, those people are sleeping fine.
Mm.
They are not losing any sleep at night. And what's even more, which goes back to love and understanding love, what we don't realize is people can only love you as far as, or as deep as they have love within them. So the things that your mom or your dad did not give you, I promise you, it has something to do with the things that their mom and their dad did not give them. The person that makes you a victim is always a victim. Always, but we don't see that because we get so caught up in what we received or didn't. They're always a victim. The person that molested that child, I bet you, you'll find some kind of way where they were molested too. And we miss out on the opportunity of breaking these chains because we don't see that. We don't see both sides of the situation. So you have to forgive others in order for you to successfully move forward. And then lastly, change your mind about how you feel about yourself. And I know I say that like it's so easy to do. And the reason why is because it is. And I'm gonna give you an example as to why. There was probably about 4 or 5 years ago, I used to work at the Virginian Pilot, and we had this room where we got our coffee and stuff from. And this guy, he went and poured himself some coffee. And when he poured the coffee, he drank the coffee and immediately got mad. He was upset. Why is this coffee cold? Who has cold coffee? Why in the world am I drinking cold coffee? Who in the world left the thing off? What in the world's wrong with y'all? Who has cold coffee? Went off. Clearly, he does not like cold coffee. But flip it. About 2 months later, we went out to Starbucks. He went to the front of the line, and they asked him what was he had. He ordered his drink, and they asked him, did he want it hot or cold? I was like, man, I know this answer. He said he wanted it cold. It blew my mind. What you mean you want cold coffee? Did you not see yourself 2 months ago? And then I realized something. He was not mad because the coffee was cold. He was mad because he had an expectation about the coffee that he poured. So he decided to be mad when it did not align with his expectation. And this is what we do. See, you decide how you feel, and how you feel is reflection of your expectations of outside sources. So what we do is we have expectations of outside sources, and when they do not align with our expectations, we get or decide to be mad. It's a decision, always. And when we have outside expectations and they align with our expectations, we decide to be happy. Every single time. Just think about any kind of time where you've been mad or upset. It bothers me to hear. People say it all the time. She made me mad. What? How'd she do that? You decide to be mad, happy, glad, sad, whatever. It's always a decision that you make. And it's all predicated on your expectation. So you can do one of two things. You can change your expectations or not have any for outside sources. Or you can decide that the outside source is not going to determine how you feel. It's up to you. But please know that every time you get mad or upset or frustrated, you're making a decision to do it. Mm-hmm. Every single time. The only thing that you can't really control is love, how you feel about someone. Which is why, if you're married, you should not spend that much time with people that you're with. I mean, people that are not your spouse, because you, through time, can fall in love with someone else. Just by sheer experience or spending time with that other person. That's what should prevent you from doing so. Which is a good segue is arguments. Talking about expectations. Arguments. The reason why we have arguments is because of one or a few ingredients, and that is two narrow-minded people trying to force their views on each other. Mm-hmm. Say that again. The only way you can have an argument is if you have these ingredients. Two narrow-minded people trying to force their views on each other. Case in point. If you and I are having a conversation, and my sole objection is to share how I feel or my thoughts and to understand how you feel without me trying to make you agree or feel how I feel, there's no way we can have an argument. If both parties are doing the same thing, there's absolutely no way. But what happens is I'm sharing what I'm sharing because I want you to say I agree with you. And then you share and you don't, so we go back and forth. And we get mad. No, you don't understand. Translation, no, you don't see it how I feel. You don't see it the way that I see it. And that's the problem. That's what causes an argument. Not the fact that people just can't converse. It's just your thought process. I want to make you agree or feel like I feel. And that's what causes arguments. And I'm going to go from that to this whole journey now. I wanted to address self-esteem because this is the theme of the actual event. But now I want to actually build a house from no love to no love by going into the different things that you need to build a house to do so. And now, self-esteem is clearly the foundation. After that, it's effective communication. And in order for us to have effective communication, tell me if I'm wrong, you hear it all the time. If you want to have a successful marriage, you got to communicate. You got to communicate. You got to communicate. That is such a broad statement. Nobody ever sits down and explains to you what that means. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss the three roots of poor communication. The three roots of poor communication. So if you identify these, now again, I told you, I'm going to snatch some truth from you. So this is where I'm going to do it, or one of the places anyway. So the first root of poor communication is going to be, it's pretty obvious, and that would be a poor vocabulary. Now, That's pretty obvious. If you don't have a vocabulary, words are the bridge, are the pieces of a bridge to get a message across. If you don't have enough words, you're not gonna get your message to the person. So that's one thing. If you don't have a vocabulary, you're gonna have a problem communicating. But another issue that we have is people use words that they do have that in a manner that do not align with the definition. So can you imagine me wanting you to stand up, but you're sitting down, and I'm saying, sit down! Sit down! Sit down! But I want you to stand up, but I'm yelling, sit down. If it does not meet the definition, we end up getting mad at the person for not doing what it is that we ask. But we do it all the time. I had a girl call me, she's talking, and she was telling me something. We had mutual friends. She said, could you do me a favor and delay the message for me? And I said, I sure can. When can I tell them? And she was like, well, what are you talking about? I said, how long do I have to wait? She said, what you mean? I said, how long of a delay is it going to be? And she still didn't get it. Now this is serious because she's in college for a law degree. And I said, well, do you mean that you want me to relay the message? I said, because the delay means to withhold for a certain period of time, or we're not gonna be on time, or however you want to break that up. Say, I think, do you mean relay, like relay race, I pass it on? And she's like, you know what I mean. You know what I mean. I said, well, I'm gonna need you to know what you mean and mean what you say. So there's a lot of people a lot of men that's in jail because they thought they knew what the girl meant when she said no. Got deep then. Mm-hmm. People use words that don't align with definitions all the time and get mad at you when you don't reply to them in a manner that aligns with what they're asking for. It's crazy. And all it does is cause you to get upset. It's interesting that the people that are in jail for the violent crimes, they are the highest percentage for not being able to read or write. Which makes sense to me, because if you don't have words to express how you feel, that is frustrating. You see it all the time. You see a foreigner, you might ask for direction somewhere. Hey, could you tell me how to get to whatever? No speaking of English. Can you ask me, or can you tell me how to get to, why do we yell in English to people that don't speak English? You are yelling to help somebody understand what they don't understand. But we do it all the time, and we don't realize that's what we do in arguments. Instead of trying to figure out how to help them understand what we're saying, we try to say it louder. You gotta change, you gotta find some form of translation. They're not receiving it the way that you're doing it. Yelling is not gonna help. Figure out how to translate. Okay? Second thing. So, vocabulary, please read more. And learn the definitions of the words that you are getting. Second thing is generalizing males and females. I'm gonna start getting pushback. Generalizing males and females. Why is that a root of poor communication? Well, what you think you know about a person, you won't ask about. And if you generalize males and females, you think you know that male, or you think you know that female. So certain things that you think you know, you're not gonna ask about. So if I think you know what's 5 plus 5, I'm not gonna ask you, hey man, what you think about 5 plus 5? You know something about 5 plus 5? Do you know? I'm gonna treat you like you know what 5 plus 5 is by never asking about it. And then if you do something that does not align, I'm gonna get upset. So what we do is, and it's sad, we buy these books. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. Act like a lady, think like a man. To read a book to try to learn about my man or my woman instead of spending time with my man and my woman and asking them questions to help me understand. Let's first debunk this whole generalization of male and female. If all men were the same and all women were the same, that would mean every single man and woman would be compatible. Just by default. We do it all day though. We generalize, you know how men are. You know how women are. If this was true, every male and female would be compatible off the top. Let's debunk it a little more. If every male and female, if you were able to generalize them, if every male was the same and every female was the same, there would be no such thing as homosexuality. Not possible. Because all men are the same and all women are the same. So either all men are going to be gay, or all men are going to be straight, or all females are going to be gay, or all females are going to be straight. There's no in between. Again, we do it all the time though. And we take advice from these people. You know how men are. Men, you know, they could just have sex with no feelings. Y'all heard that before? Mm-hmm. I bet y'all probably was in that conversation. Mm-hmm. Let me debunk that. Porn is probably the most lucrative business, and who is the most active person in the porn industry? A female. All day long. I don't think they're putting too much emotion into that. How about prostitution? It's not that many prostitution rings with males in it. It seems like I can prove that females can just take off emotion from sex all day long. It has nothing to do with females or males. Like I said, I'm not going to teach you anything. I'm going to help you realize stuff that's right in your face. But they're teaching this stuff and making you think this stuff, and you're going about the same thing. They're just repackaging you. You're receptive to Steve Harvey. So when he said, girl, he right. And what happens is, when they speak and tell you stuff, you get one thing that you can align with, and you're like, girl, that's the truth. But man, he right, he hitting right on. Not even questioning the fact, polls, this kills me, statistics, all day long. You will read a statistic and be like, hey man, this is on the phone. They know us. Not even thinking about the fact that the statistic, you've never been polled. You believe in a statistic that you were never polled in. They never called you and asked you a question about it. But you believe the statistic, clearly flawed. We take these words and we run with it. The worst thing you can do is generalize a male or female. Treat every person as an individual. That way you will be forced to learn more about that person. But if you think because he's a man, chapter 7 said, rub him in the back of his ear, and that's gonna start it, you're gonna get that man that's like, what are you, girl, if you don't stop touching me like that, what are you doing? Don't touch my ears. But we do it all the time. We read books to help us understand another person. No book can tell you how to understand your mate. Only time with your mate, and if they're being honest when you ask questions about it, will teach you about their mate. And if they know themselves. But we've already talked about that. Self-esteem, ask yourself why. You need to understand yourself. Third thing, I'm really going to get pushed back. Probably people going to leave you, because I'm about to snatch a serious truth from you. The belief in common sense. Oh, what? Yeah, I told you. The belief in this thing called common sense. Let me debunk this for you so I can help you understand why this prevents you from being an effective communicator. First of all, when we say that's common sense, what are we really saying? The only time we say, all right, let me define common sense. When you say something is common sense, correct me if I'm wrong, do you not mean everybody knows that?
Mm-hmm.
Correct me if I'm wrong. And when you say, well, that's common sense, aren't you really saying everybody knows that? But when do we say that's common sense? When somebody does the opposite of what everybody knows? This bothers me, babe. You know how I get frustrated about this.
I know.
Because, again, what we think people already know we don't discuss. You get your common sense from your life's experience, your teaching, your upbringing, your parents, all of that stuff defines your common sense. And even Siamese twins don't have the same perspective. There's so many things that you can pour into. You have kinesthetic learners, you have visual learners, you have people that are auditory learners. People learn differently, people see things in different points of views, people will look at the same thing and have a different conclusion. All those things play a factor in the way you think. And what happens is, we take stuff to make us feel good about our decision making and make it common sense. Give you a story. There's a guy, many, many years ago, he came from West Coast. Came. It was about a week or so, either before or after, so long ago, the 4th of July. Somebody set off some firecrackers. This dude dove face first inside some bushes. Face first. Survival mode. And we laughed at him. What the heck is wrong with him? Common sense will tell you it's 4th of July. People got firecrackers or whatever. But what we found out was he lived in South Central. When you hear pop, pop, pop where he's at, common sense will tell you to get your tail on the floor. So, depending on where you are, is where you're going to get, or your upbringing is where you're going to get your quote-unquote common sense. Let me speed this along. When you think something is common sense, that is a key point in when you're supposed to sit the person down and have a conversation about why you feel the way you feel or think the way you think. Because what we do is, we say, okay, common sense will tell him, and you get mad at him or her for something that they really did not know. And you never gave them an opportunity to know where to even fix it. Because you think and believe in Santa Claus. I mean, common sense. There's no such thing as common sense. What you do is, when you think something is common sense, you sit the person down and say, hey, this is why I feel this way. This is how my upbringing caused me to think or feel the same way or feel this way. And you explain it to them. We got so many people thinking that they're disrespected and all this stuff because they never took the time to help them understand why they feel the way that they feel or think the way that they think. All day long. See it all the time. And what do? When we think something's common sense and get mad at them? We call the people that taught us our common sense and tell them what they did. And they be like, well, girl, that's common sense. He would have told them. They never talked to the other person. So now they're just fueling that quote-unquote common sense. Everybody know that, girl. He disrespectful. Never talking to the person that caused them to be upset. Check my time. All right. So now that y'all mad at me for snatching that from me, 5 minutes, I'm going to go real quick. All right. So we're going to go into the different phases, real quick, on different things that you need to be a parent or know about. Dating. First of all, let's talk about the importance of dating, because a lot of people don't like to do it. And I had a young lady, she's like, I know you found your wife and you're happy, but wouldn't you have rather just, met her in the beginning and not go through all that mess? I said, no, ma'am, not at all. Anybody like fruit in the audience? Raise your hand. What's your favorite fruit? Strawberries. All right, so say somebody, they called you, hey, girl, I got some strawberries for you. I got a whole bunch of strawberries, and I got a box of them, and I wanted to tell you about it because I thought about you. I was like, yeah, I got all these strawberries. Let me get this. I know my girl loves some strawberries. Let me get you some strawberries. She called you at work. You're like, girl, I'm gonna hurry. As soon as I leave from work, I'm gonna get me some strawberries, right? You probably can't wait to get off. Looking at the clock, so you get all the way to her house. Finally, girl, where are my strawberries at? She get there, she bring it to the box, she open up the box, and it's a whole box of strawberry seeds. She didn't lie to you. She got you a whole box of strawberries. You mad, you were hot. Why are you mad? Because you had in your mind what the strawberries were, right? All right, so the point of this story is, a blessing too early is not a blessing. If you don't have anybody right now, it's because you're a seed. And you need to grow. So that once you do find a person that's right for you, they're going to appreciate you and not feel like they got a seed. So I'm so glad my wife did not meet me when I was a seed, because she probably would have threw me away and missed out on the opportunity to have the tree that she has now. Okay. All right? So let me go ahead and Alright. So, it's important to date. Now, biggest issue we have with dating, though, what we do is, we don't want to waste our time. Nobody likes to waste their time. So, what happens is, people ask you, hey girl, what you looking for in the mail? Or, what you looking for in the man? Why y'all on a date? And what we do is, we're like, man, that's a pretty simple question. I feel that's all right. So we go tell them, I want this, this, this. I ain't got time for this, 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 and this. And what we don't realize we're doing is, we're allowing them to take notes on how to act so that they can get the cookie. And then as time goes by, you saying, well, dang, you used to do this or whatever. Well, yeah, I used to do that, but I got what I needed, and I'm falling in. Now, even a good person now, it's not all bad people. Even a good person is gonna, if they really like you, they're gonna try to live up to what you told them. So the worst thing you can do is tell somebody what it is that they're looking for, and you're looking for in a mate, because it will force them to act a certain way. People do it all the time. Don't do that, all right? Then, after that, have a list, first of all, as what you're looking for. That's a definite. You have to do that, because if you're going out looking for something but you don't know what it looked like, guess what you're never gonna find? That. Somebody needs you to know what you're looking for in a male or female, but not in the physical form. We're talking morals, values, characteristics, and stuff like that. I promise you, whoever you end up marrying, if you're not married, doesn't look like anything, anybody in your prom pictures or who you went with prior to. My wife looks nothing like who I was with prior to her. Nothing like her. Nothing like what I thought was my, what I thought was what I was looking for. So, when you're dating, make sure you sit. It doesn't matter. It's not going to stop me. When you're dating, make sure you keep on dating until you find someone that meets the entire list. Do not move forward without going with someone that meets the entire list. Because you're going to go into something that's going to already have problems with problems. So you need to go with someone that you're going to be willing to go through the wilderness with, because they have everything you've been looking for in a male or female. Okay? All right. So let's move to relationships really quickly here. Is that like my Oscars music? Okay. Relationships. It's not that they don't love you, they don't love alike. Remember, we just talked about that. People, they think differently, or they feel a certain way. So if you don't explain to them why you feel a certain way, they're doing stuff out of habit. You've chosen someone that loves you off the top. They love you off the top. So nothing that they're going to do is going to be intentionally to harm you. So if a guy touches you a certain way, you don't like it, don't just say, girl, don't touch me like that, I don't like that. You need to provide them with the story, because what you're doing is breaking a habit. So think about it. He touched you that way because he likes you, or he wants to feel or share some his emotions or how he loves you. But when you snatch from him, you say you don't like it because just don't touch me. But he did it out of a habit. It's hard to break a habit. But if you said, think about it. If he touched you, he said, hey, don't touch me like that. The last guy that touched me like that, he tried to rape me. Now you caused him to say, well, dang. You've broken a pattern. It's going to be easier for him to remember why you should not touch me like that. It'll break a pattern. I really, really wish I had more time, but this is my time, and at least we discussed self-esteem. I really appreciate your minds and time. I love y'all dearly. God bless you and every person.
Give it up for Fairley. I wish you had more time too, brother, because I was back there getting into that. That forgiveness part, forgiving yourself, that's something I have a problem with. And everything that you was talking about, you thank you very much. Give it up once again for Ann Fairley. That was awesome, wasn't that? I thoroughly enjoyed that, and I really hope that we can do this again. Would you like to have more of these types of events? Please let Tysha know. Be louder than that. You can be louder than that. Let her know you would like to have more of these events. I'm going to let Joe.